with us on remotely, stand back and sing out even from home. Enjoy the goodness of God this morning.
When darkness tries to roll over my bones, when sorrow comes to steal the joy I own, when brokenness and pain is all I know, I won't be shaken, I won't be shaken. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. Shame no longer has a place to hide. I am not a captive to the lies. I'm not afraid to leave my past behind. I won't be shaken, I won't be shaken. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. There's power that can break off every chain. There's resurrection power that can save. There's power in your name, power in your name. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love.
So since the last time we met, we got to celebrate the Chiefs winning back-to-back AFC championships. That's awesome, huh? So, woohoo! We got. And as exciting as that was, and as exciting, big of a football fan as I am, isn't it awesome to know that we serve a risen Savior that has won for us the ultimate victory? We don't have to worry about overtime or the two-minute warning. We know that we serve a risen Savior that we will see face to face one day because He has risen again. Think about that as we sing our next song, I Will Rise.
There's a peace I've come to know, though my heart and flesh may fail. There's an anchor for my soul. I can say it is well. Jesus has overcome.
Good morning, church. How are you this morning? It's so good to see you all this morning. Thank you for worshiping with us, especially those who are worshiping online. I'm so glad that you join us in worship service. May the Lord bless us, surprise us as we worship together in one voice. All right, so we have one announcement from Phoebe.
I'm afraid it might be more than one. This morning, I invite you to ponder the Valley Center Food Pantry donation for the month of February is canned fruit. And next week, being the Super Bowl, we're going to have our Super Bowl, meaning bring a can of soup, multiple cans of soup. There'll be containers in the hallway, and you can put your soup in the team that you wish will win the Super Bowl, and we will announce our Super Bowl winner Monday morning online. All those donations go to the Valley Center Food Pantry. Also, giving statements are available upon request. Contact the office. They can be emailed or printed, and you can pick it up in the office. Ash Wednesday is February 17th. There'll be a service here in the sanctuary at 6:30 p.m. Also, the service will be live streamed if you would like to watch, and they'll be preparing some Ash Wednesday packets that can be picked up prior to the service. Please contact the office by February 10th if you would like one of those packets or several, and they can be picked up before the service on February 17th. Some Lenten study opportunities. The details are given in your online bulletin. However, just a couple of quick announcements. There'll be a Sunday afternoon study titled Restored, taught by myself at 3 o'clock Sunday afternoons during Lent. The progressive class is meeting Monday nights, and they're going to study Entering the Passion of Jesus. Pastor is going to lead one titled Give Up Something Bad for Lent. That will be a Wednesday evening at 6 p.m. So any of those are open to everyone in the congregation. Feel free to view those details on your bulletin to see more extensive description of each class. We are beginning Sunday school classes and small groups next week, and so we're kind of gathering topics that people are going to be studying, and June has submitted something for Insight titled Follow, and the details of that class study that will begin February 7th are in your bulletin as well. One more thing, we had a blessing this week that the Menacause group here in Valley Center awarded Main Street Threads a $1,000 grant, and we have this wonderful large check. This will be shared at a service this afternoon online to the group itself, and I imagine these pictures will find their way to the Arc Valley News, and we're just so grateful for their contribution to the thrift store that will go toward our operating costs. Thank you. Let's give our hands to them. Thank you very much.
I know we don't have any children among us today, but I'm pretty sure we have a children watching right now with their parents online. So I'd love to share a message with you this morning. But I need a couple of volunteers. Jesse and Eric, would you mind be volunteers for me today? You can stay where you are. One for you and one for you. All right. So. Okay, so the Bible tells us to praise Him and sing His name, you know, all the time. In the morning, in the evening, when we get up, during the lunch hour, you know, before we go to bed. So this morning we're going to practice that, okay? I'm going to read a passage, Psalm 150, all right? And then when you hear the word, I mean, you can just grab anything at home, all right? Just paper or anything, or raise hand. When you hear the word, when you hear the word praise, I want you to, you know, raise your flag high. And we're going to have Mr. Aaron and Jesse will give us a demonstration, all right? So, okay. So, you guys ready? Okay. Praise the Lord. Praise God in His sanctuary. Praise Him in His mighty firmament. Praise Him for His mighty deeds. Praise Him according to His surpassing greatness. Praise Him with a trumpet sound. Praise Him with a lute and harp. Praise Him with a tambourine and dance. And praise Him with the strings and pipe, praise Him with the clanging cymbals, praise Him with the loud clashing cymbals. Let everything that praise the Lord and praise the Lord. Good job. Let's give our hands to Aaron. Good job. Thank you. Thank you, guys. Thank you. So, why do you think we praise God? Why? Because our God is good. Our God is loving. He loves us. He loves us so much that He gave His only Son so that, you know, we are given eternal life. You know, with Him, we're going to spend eternity with Him. He's so good, God. So that's why we praise Him for the rest of our lives. All right? So let us pray. God, we praise You this morning. Amen. Okay, thanks, guys. So we have birthday folks this week. I'm going to read those people. Greg Jacquees and Karen Williams, Madeline Cade, Stephen Livingood, Tom Bartel, Janice Sipe, Aaron Lindstrom, Sailor Thornton, Landon Taylor. Anybody also have birthday I'm missing? All right, happy birthday, everybody, especially Aaron is here this morning. Continue to pray for a couple of our folks who lost their loved ones. Kent Turner, and pray for his wife, Sukja Han, who and the family members will mourn in the love of Kent. And also Julie, Rebecca Schultz, the other day, her father-in-law passed away. So please keep them in your prayers. And also pray for Judy Dellinger. She's a lady who comes to a first service, and she hasn't been back to church for a long time due to her health issues. And you know, this past week she's infected, tested positive. You know, it's such a difficult time for an elderly lady going back to the hospital, back and forth to the nursing home. So please pray for a quick recovery and patience and endurance and God's comfort during this difficult time for her. And also pray for Eldon and June Fike. They've been in the nursing home in Newton, and they had a minor stroke this past week and having some therapies. So please pray for them for the restoration of their bodies. Let us pray. Gracious God, we offer thanks for this day and for the opportunity to be here together in worship. During this time, may we be able to put aside the concerns of our daily lives, let go of all the demands that crowd upon us, and simply be present here to Your Spirit and Your words. In the spirit of the psalm, may we be still and know that You are our God. Lord, hear our prayers as we pray for those who are in need of You. Bless those who are dealing with cancer. This morning we name them before You: Dale James, Jerry Browning, Gary Hitton, and Jody Lewis' brother, George Masquerade. Lord, give them hope, the courage they need each day. Comfort them in their spirit and bless them with healing. Lord, we also lift up those who are recovering from the current surgeries and other sicknesses. And we name them before You: Judy Dellinger and June and Eldon Fike. We thank You because they are making progress day by day. With Your loving mercies, healing power, they will one day recover health. We pray for those who are struggling with flu, coronavirus, and other illness. Lord, heal them and make them well. We lift up Rebecca Schultz family and Turner family in our prayers this morning. Please comfort them. Console those who are grieving in the loss of their loved ones. Let them be comforted in the remembrance of Your promises. Give to those who mourn peace in the midst of their tears. God of love and hope, we are thankful for healing. After these months of anxiety and sorrow and isolation because of this COVID-19, we are truly grateful for a vaccine that offers us respite and peace. As vessels of Your love and grace, open our bodies to immunity, Your healing light. Help us continue to make wise choices, not only for ourselves, but for those whom we encounter. Be with the healthcare workers who are working medically to care for those suffering from this virus, who are doing all they can do to make this vaccine available to everybody. Lord, we thank you for being with us, listening to our prayers and answering them. This we pray in Jesus' name, and all God's people say, Amen. Please stand if you are able for reading of God's word. Today's scripture is taken from the book of Colossians. Book of Colossians, chapter 3, verses 15 through 17. And let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, to which indeed you are called in one body. And be thankful. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly, teaching and admonishing one another in all wisdom, singing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs with thankfulness in your hearts to God. And whatever you do in word or deed, do everything in the name of the Lord, giving thanks to God, Father, through Him. This is the word of God for the people of God. You may be seated.
I searched the world, but it couldn't fill me. Man's empty praise, treasures of fame, are never enough. And you came along and put me back together. And every desire is now satisfied here in your love.
Oh, there's nothing better than you. There's nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing, nothing is better than you.
Not afraid to show you my weakness, the failures and flaws, Lord, you've seen them all, and you still call me friend. 'Cause the God of the mountain is the God of the valley. There's not a place your mercy and grace won't find me again.
Oh, there's nothing better than you. There's nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing, nothing is better than you. Oh, there's nothing better than you. Oh, there's nothing better than you. Lord, there's nothing, nothing is better than you. You turn mourning to dancing. Beauty for ashes. You turn shame into glory. You're the only one who can. You turn mourning to dancing. You give beauty for ashes. You turn shame into glory. You're the only one who can. You turn graves into gardens. You turn bones into armies. You turn seas into highways. You're the only one who can. You're the only one who can. There's nothing better than you. There's nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing. Nothing is better than you. Oh, there's nothing better than you. There's nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing. Nothing is better than you. You turn praise into gardens. You turn bones into armies. You turn seas into highways. You're the only one who can. You turn graves into gardens. You turn bones into armies. You turn seas into highways. You're the only one who can. You're the only one who can. You're the only one who can.
Thank you, Praise Band, for singing and reminding us there's nothing better than you, O Lord. Oh, my. Yeah. So, I mean, just coming to second service and learn songs that I don't know, and it's a privilege and benefit. So, when I listen to the radio station, Christian radio station on the highway, and listen to some songs that I learned from the Praise Band, oh, this is a song I know. And the singer over there, he sings kind of like, you know, the way the Kelly sings, the tones. And I was like, yes, yeah. So thank you again for sharing wonderful special music with us. Today's the last Sunday of the sermon series called Resolution. So far we've been talking about six resolutions. You guys remember? Compassion, kindness, and then humility and meekness, and last Sunday, patience and forgiveness. Today, we come to the last one, seventh. I know there are couple more resolutions I can pick, like worship or, you know, dwelling, the word of Christ dwelling in us, but, you know, we've covered it like a couple of years ago already, so we're just going to focus on the one resolution called sing. I know you guys were wanting to sing, but because of this coronavirus since last March, it was really hard to sing in public, you know. And thank you for being patient with us. You know, we want to sing, right? You know, Methodist people are known for two things. The first one, we are known for singing people, right? And the second one, we're known for food. Right. I miss, you know, singing, but I also miss, you know, having potluck dinner with my fellow brothers and sisters. I hope that, you know, time come and, you know, really enjoy fellowship again. Oh, this morning, I'd like to take a moment to think about, you know, why should we sing? And how should we sing in light of today's scripture? There is a young lady by the name of Stacy Horn. At the age of 26, she goes through divorce. And that divorce actually, you know, made her depressed and saddened her life and her situations. So she was looking for something that cheer up. And her friends and family members, you know, would give her some guidance and suggestions. So she tried different things. First, she, you know, learned to play banjo instrument. It was okay, but it didn't much help. So, and then he learned to play some dance. Especially she picked up hip-hop dance. It was okay, but it didn't help. And then she tried other things, like she was kayaking with her friends. It was okay, but it didn't last long. And the last thing that she did, she actually joined the choir. She joined the choir at the Choral Society of Grace Church in New York. She had an audition. I watched this, you know, testimony. And she did horrible, but they accepted her. So they gathered together once a week and sing some songs. And there's a, you know, something changes start happening as she's singing. She wrote this book called Imperfect Harmony. So, you know, finding happiness singing with others. That's the subtitle. And in this book, she's talked about, you know, power of singing in the choir. And we really, you know, relieved her anxiety, relieved her stress, and relieved her painful memories as she sang with, you know, a bunch of choir members. And she wrote this book 30 years after she was divorced. You know, research has found that the people feel more positive after actively singing than they do passively listening to music, or, you know, after chatting, you know, positive about the positive ideas. They said, you know, when people sing, there's like a neurochemicals were released, such as endorphin, beta endorphin, and dopamine. And then the third one is the serotonin. So three neurochemicals were coming out as they were singing. And then the people's mood is increased. And there's a psychologist, his name is Nick Stewart at Bath University. He talks about, you know, five benefits of the singing in the choir. I want to take a look at it, okay? So first, when you sing in the choir, it happened. This is what happened. Strengthen feeling of togetherness. They said people who participate in a choir enjoy a greater feeling of togetherness and being part of collective endeavors than others involved in different social activities. And I'm pretty sure it applies to, you know, our church praise band as well. Do you feel the same? Do you feel like, you know, feeling of togetherness as you guys practice, as you guys sing together? Praise band. Okay, good. I'm glad to hear that. Yeah. That's how I feel when I come to practice Wednesday and singing Sunday morning. I feel, you know, sense of belonging and togetherness. And here's the second one. So regulate heart rate. They discovered that members of the choir saw their heart rate beat in unison in relation to the speed of their breathing. Heart rate were directly affected by the melody of the music, and the pulses of those tested rose and fell at the same time when they sung in a group. Do you guys feel that too? Do you guys feel the heartbeat, same heartbeat, you know, at the melody of the music with other singers? Probably not much, right? But that's what it says. Regulate heart rates. And then third one, reduce stress levels and depression. One study lasting for a year involving participants who had been diagnosed with depression found that some of them no longer met the diagnosis following their involvement with a choir. I know, you know, sometimes life is full of stress, right? You know, including myself. And what happened was, when I come to Wednesday practice choir, sometimes I come with a lot of anxiety and fear, but I don't tell them. But as I, you know, pick up some songs and focusing on the lyrics of the music, wow, it actually moves me. Thank you, Lord, for speaking to me. And I find really joy and excitement back. I'm pretty sure the same is true other choir members. You know, it reduces stress levels and depression. And this is the fourth one. Improve symptoms of Parkinson's and lung disease. And then fifth, improve feeling of social well-being. And this psychologist study found that participants in choral singing reported a higher rate of social well-being on one of the measures than solo singers. So, you know, finding out all these benefits of singing in the choir, how many of you guys ready to join in the choir or join in the praise band next Sunday? There's a sign-up sheet ready for you guys when you guys leave. Well, some of you guys might say, I'm not a singer. Well, I can't really sing people like in the praise band or in the choir. That's okay. But even though you can't sing, even though you sound bad, if you sing together with the person sitting next to you, just like where you are right now, then there is this benefit. Sing with the person sitting next to you, you receive this benefit. And it's good for us. Whether you come to first service singing a lot of hymns, or whether you come to second service singing a lot of contemporary songs, it doesn't matter. You know, we are experiencing this benefit that psychologists are talking about. And the reason, according to Apostle Paul, that we sing is because the word of Christ is dwelling in us. It speaks to us, it changes us, it moves us, and out of gratitude, we sing psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs. So this morning, I want us to take a moment to look at, you know, a couple of questions. Why? Why we ought to sing? Why we are called to sing? And how we ought to sing. The first, why? Why should we sing? It's because we are created to sing. All of us, you know, we are made in the image of God, and we are created to sing because we are created in His image. Think about the human nature, okay? Think about, you know, the baby in mother's tummy. You know, we have a young parents here, and me and my wife have gone through when the baby's in mother's tummy, and what happens when mother or father sings, you know, the baby moves around in the tummy, right? Maybe they like to listen to father, or they don't stop it. Either one, right? But and then when the baby was born, what do? When baby cries, you hold it and then you sing rullaby song. In Korea, it's the jajanga. Jal jara. We put them into sleep, or they wake you up. Either one. And then when they become 2 or 3 years or maybe 4 years old, what happened? They fall into music like Baby Shark. Baby Shark, Baby Shark, you guys know the song? Come on. I'm pretty sure, you know, Jesse can tell us, you know, those kids fall in love with those music. And then probably when the next level, when they move up, maybe 5 years or 6 years old, they fall in love with Disney, you know, songs, right? Like for example, my Jenna fall in love with, you know, Frozen, Let It Go, Let It Go, not anymore, but it's the age. And then when they go into teenage period, they listen to different, like, you know, groups and, you know, pop songs and BTS. For my son's case, a lot of rap music, always rap music. I have to listen to the rap music in the car. Come on, I want to listen to 91.5, you know, Chris, Jeffrey, change the channels to rap. I have no idea what they're singing, but only words that I can catch are like bad words that I could hear. Come on, Jeffrey, let's stop listening to this. And then when they go to college, when they start dating, they love to sing love songs. Always listening, when they hear the love songs coming out of the radio or a CD, then you sing along and thinking about your love. Think about how many love songs coming out each week. And then as time goes on, people are falling in love with different musics. And that's how we are created. We are created to sing from the infant age all the way to the end. And this is really interesting. When you look at God, and this is what, you know, Zephaniah chapter 3, verse 17 says, "The Lord your God is in your midst, a mighty one who will save. He will rejoice over you with gladness. He will quiet you by his love, and he will exalt over you with a loud singing." You see, he will exalt you and me over us with a loud singing. I mean, the scripture tells us that God is singing for us, loud singing. What about Jesus? Right after the Passover, right after the Lord's Supper, in Matthew chapter 20, verse 30, it says, "When they had sung a hymn, they went out to the Mount of Olives. The night before, you know, Jesus was crucified on the cross, they gathered in the upper room. But, you know, as they were about to move to the Mount of Olives, Jesus and his disciples sung a hymn." What kind of hymn? I would guess hymn about God or God's grace, his forgiveness, or his mighty, and so on and so forth. So if God sings and we are created in his image, what are we supposed to do? We are created to the sing. Whether you are classically trained, whether you are so-so singers, whether you sound really bad, doesn't matter. We are created to sing. Here's the second reason. Why should we sing? It's because we are told to do so. We are commanded to sing. I'm going to read verse 16. "Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly, teaching and admonishing one another in all wisdom, singing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs with thankfulness in your heart to God." The reason why we sing is because the scripture, the word of God, says so. The reason why the choir, the reason why our praise band leading us in our service was not just for the sermon opener, was not just that, you know, we enjoy listening to their special music, was not, but it was that, you know, we can sing along. That's the main reason. And then, you know, Apostle Paul continued to say, yeah, we sing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs. Here's another scripture that I share with the children during the children's moment is Psalm 150, you know, verse 6. "Let everything that has breath praise the Lord and praise the Lord." Let us read together in one voice. "Let everything that has breath praise the Lord and praise the Lord." You and I, we have a breath. We are breathing. As long as you and I are breathing, What do we do? We praise, we sing His name. It's what we are called to do. We are commanded to sing. Here, Apostle Paul, you know, talks about covering different types of music. You know, one commentary that I read, it says that the Psalms are songs that are actually quoted from the Bible, especially the Book of Psalms. You know, when you think about those 150 Psalms, they're beautiful poems, aren't they? But they are song themselves. And we sing psalms, those psalms. And then sing hymns. Hymns that we sing usually accompanied by the instrument, strings. And then spiritual songs refers to, you know, any kind of music that is spiritual. So what we see here, according to Apostle Paul, you know, we could sing variety of songs, whether it is a piano, organ, you know, we sing hymnals, whether we sing contemporary music with the band's electric guitars and bass guitars and keyboard and, you know, drum, doesn't matter. We could sing variety of songs. It, you know, Bible, God gives us a little freedom, you know, to sing different kinds of musics. Now, I want us to talk about how should we sing, how we ought to sing, what is involved in singing, what is the good sing from the biblical perspective. And I believe that good worship involves in singing together. It involves others. And this is what the scripture says, verse 15. Let the peace of Christ rule in your heart, to which indeed you are called in one body. As one body, you know, we are called to sing together. How we ought to sing? You know, we sing with our fellow brothers and sisters as a one body. I mean, you know, that's why we come to church, gather together in corporate setting, and we sing together in one voice, because that's what is prescribed here. As one body, you know, we sing together. See, good singing, good worship is involved in singing and worshiping with other brothers and sisters. Some of you guys might say, no, and I like, you know, I like to sing on my own, with my YouTube and online service. And some of them might say, well, I like to sing my favorite songs when I'm in the car, when I'm walk. I mean, that's a good way. I encourage you doing it. But, you know, generally, you know, we ought to sing together with our fellow brothers and sisters. So it's very interesting, you know, as we learn from those psychologists, from those research, that, you know, when we sing together, I don't know, you probably don't think about it, you probably never thought about it, when we sing together along with praise band, your heartbeat, my heartbeat, you know, we have the same heartbeat. And then maybe when we sing a little faster song, like, right? Same heartbeat, the same pace. That's what this discovery of those psychologists and research. And that reminds me, you know, when we sing together, we become one. We become one in unity, in harmony. And the other thing that, you know, we could have a mistake, because, you know, some of you guys think that singing might not be one of the, you know, spiritual disciplines. When you think about spiritual discipline, it's more like prayer, fasting, and reading the scripture. But in my opinion, I believe worshiping, singing is also spiritual discipline. You know, coming to church every Sunday is not just to watch. It's not just to check in out. But I believe the coming to church every Sunday is something that you and I, we are called to participate in it. That's why we encourage you to sing. I know, you know, with this COVID and masks on, it's difficult. But it's something that we all of us are called to participate in it. And the last one, you know, according to Apostle Paul, we sing with thankfulness. How should we sing? Sing with gratitude. He talks about two times in today's scripture. We are thankful, and we have this gratitude. And that gratitude, thankfulness, leads us to, you know, singing. And who do we singing to? We're not singing to ourselves, but we are singing to God. That's what the scripture says. Let me read it one more time. You know, let the message of Christ dwell among you richly as you teach and admonish one another with all wisdom through psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing to God with gratitude in your heart. You are not the one. We are not the ones, but it is God. We are singing to God. How about turn to the person sitting next to you and then say, singing is not for you, shall we? Singing is not for you. Singing is for God. God should be the consumer of our singing. God should be the consumer of our worship. Brothers and sisters, you know, we have a variety of ages of people among us today. Whether you are, you know, children, teenagers, whether you are adults, moms and dads, grandfather, grandmothers, you know, hopefully, I hope and pray that we will sing together regularly as we come to church. But that's not it. You and I, we have a responsibility to teach our children how to sing. How to sing. I don't know when, but you know, when everything is over, I hope all of you guys are ready. Maybe we might still have mask on, or maybe we don't have mask. Be ready. And sing. Sing together with our brothers and sisters. Amen. Let's pray. Lord, we want to sing better. We want to sing of you all of our days, as the psalmist says. We are created to sing. So God, please help us do that. Help us to sing with all of our hearts, with all of our minds, and with all of our strength. This we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
So as Pastor G mentioned, we find joy in song. So a good example of that is when you pull up to the traffic light and all of a sudden you look over next to you and there's somebody sitting there jamming down to their favorite tunes, right? They always look happy, and they probably share a little bit of that happiness with you. So imagine you're all sitting in your cars at the traffic light as we stand and sing our closing song, All the People Said Amen.
What we're after,
We're all broken, but we're all in this together. God knows we stumble and we fall. And he so loved the world, he sent his son to save us all. And all the people said amen. Oh, 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 and all the people said amen. Give thanks to the Lord, for his love never ends. And all the people said amen. Blessed are the poor in spirit, who are torn apart. Blessed are the persecuted and the pure in heart. Blessed are the people hungry for another star. For theirs is the kingdom of God. And all the people said amen. Whoa, oh, 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 and all the people said amen. Give thanks to the Lord, for his love never ends. And all the people said amen. And all the people said amen.
Let us be the people of singing for the rest of our lives as long as we live. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, love of God, communion, the power of the Holy Spirit be with all of us today, this week, and forevermore. Amen. Go in peace.
And all the people said amen. Oh, 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 and all the people said amen. Give thanks to the Lord, for his love never ends. And all the people said amen. And all the people said amen.
Dom, leave it on if you would.